Raise your hand if you've been touched by suicide. I think that's about everybody here. Who knows the name of that band that just sang that song? Say it up. Shout it out. Rascal Flatts. Rascal Flatts. Do any of you know? I'm going to read you a little couple quotes here. Rascal Flatts. All three members of the band have known someone close to them who committed suicide. Bassist Jay DeMarcus and his cousin Gary LeVax were affected when their uncle, who used to play with them, chose suicide as his way out. That song in particular is a really tough one because out of all our lives, nearly everyone we know has been affected by suicide. Gary and I had an uncle back in 01 that took his own life. We were very, very close to him, and we were affected by that greatly. We played music with him a lot while we grew up with him. And then the guitarist, Joe Don Rooney, which, come on, that's a great country name, Joe Don. His quote is this: it's a story, when he was asked about that song, it's a story that you get in your mind as you hear the lyrics. My friend who committed suicide was 17, the summer before senior year. It's a poignant message for youth out there, for teenagers out there struggling and contemplating that decision that they shouldn't make. You don't have to do that. There's so much more in your life to live for. There's so many other people in your life that are going to be affected by a decision like that. That's why we wrote this song. Every year, 1.3 million young people experience depression. Another 1.8 million suffer from anxiety. Suicide is still the third leading cause of death among teens ages 15 to 24. We know that these are challenging and health circumstances. We also know that there is hope, and we've seen quite a bit of hope in our own community in spite of the challenges we continue to face. And obviously, if you didn't believe that, you probably wouldn't be here tonight. So I want to commend you and thank you for taking time out of your night to be here to talk about a tough issue.
All right, yes, I'm from Oxford. Nobody throw anything at me, please. I was 14 years old when I first thought about suicide for the first time. It was, I remember I was in a baseball field near my house and was completely quiet. No one was around. I had just gotten in an argument with my parents. And to this day, I have no idea what that argument was about, but I knew it was the straw that broke the camel's back. And it was scary because I had never thought of it as an actual solution to problems. It had been something that kind of was in the outskirts of my thinking, but never was something that was something I thought was could be real. It was scary, and I remember sitting there looking out over this empty baseball field. Behind that was a wooded area that I used to play in a lot as a kid, and I just started to cry because I had never taken myself there mentally. The scary thing about the depression was that it seemed like a rational solution to what I was going through. It was something that kind of really threw me for a loop. So I went home, didn't tell anybody about it. I thought, okay, that was kind of weird. A few months later, it happened again. I had gotten a bad grade on a test. And I couldn't handle the pressure of that. You see, I was a quiet kid. I still deal with being extremely shy, even though I'm up here on stage right now. But it was something that really plagued me. I put a lot of pressure on myself. I had to get good grades, had to please my parents, even though they never put any pressure on me to do so. I just felt the need to do that. I went to a psychiatrist. My family, I finally told after I got to a point where I scared myself too much. It wasn't a full-on attempt, but it was dangerously close. And I told them, and so they took me to a psychiatrist. And the psychiatrist sat down, and I remember sitting in the room and sort of going through everything that could have been triggers. He was saying to me, are your parents divorced? How's your home life? And I remember saying, my parents are happily married. My home life is good. We started going through everything. Are you active in school? And at that point, I was playing football. I was on the track team. I was in leadership class. I went and spoke out for DARE, so I was not abusing any sort of substances. And I ended up getting put on a medication called Paxil, which was an antidepressant. And Paxil was a lifesaver going to treatment. In fact, 80% of people who receive treatment actually are very successful in doing so. So it was great, but what happened was I graduated, and like most people that may take take antidepressants, life gets pretty good, and you decide, I don't know if I really need these anymore. So I kind of threw them in a drawer and went to school. I went to Oakland University, and I immediately started feeling new pressures. I wasn't used to the fact that life continuously throws things at you. And even though I was out of high school, and I was away from bullies, and I was away from girls who broke my heart, and I was away from all of those things, I was dealing with a whole new level of problems that I wasn't prepared for. And now that I didn't have my medication, I had a hard time dealing with those. I joined a fraternity, which was great, but I met a bunch of guys, and they kept calling each other brothers, and I had no idea why they called each other brothers. They were just friends, and I had never experienced anything like that. But what I did was I met a guy named Mike, and Mike ended up saving my life. He was a really loud guy. I remember the first time I had met him, we were at a party, and I heard him come in the back door, and he had, all the guys started screaming and running and giving him kind of that one arm kind of guy hug thing and high fives. And he was a really loud guy, but he was also extremely private, and it took a long time before I got to really know him. He was the youngest of three. He had a pretty good life. His parents believed in a very simple structure. It was, you go to school, you get good grades, you get good grades, you go to a good college. You go to a good college, you get a good education, that gets you a good job. Get a good job, that would lead to you meeting a good person and getting good money. That would also lead to you having a good career. You will also have good kids, and your life will be good. And it was a very simple linear thing that the whole family had done. And it wasn't, you don't do anything crazy, you don't do anything risky, you just kind of walk that straight line. And Mike was a little bit different. He was the youngest, and he was a great guy. He wasn't someone who was disruptive. He wasn't someone that your parents would tell you to stay away from, or was mean to girls or guys. I mean, he was a really cool guy, but he kind of wanted to do his own thing a little bit. He wasn't wanting to follow that structure, and in the process kind of bummed his parents out, and his older siblings kind of used to razz him a little bit about not really following the protocol. So when I met him, he was actually coming back from Florida. He had lived down there for about a year trying to kind of explore things, see how life was for himself. And he came back because he wanted to come back to Oakland and felt a little bit more comfortable. And we got to know each other pretty well. I was working a lot of jobs, and I didn't have enough money to go to the spring break, and all my buddies were going to like Cancun and all these different places. And so he hung back with me, and a bunch of us just kind of sat around the house and played video games and did, you know, late night Taco Bell runs, and it was cool. I mean, it was just a lot of fun to kind of get to hang out with a bunch of guys. And I bumped into him. Well, he ended up going, he moved away. He still lived in the area, but he had actually left. He was done with school, he was moving on, and we kind of lost contact a little bit. We bumped into each other at meetings, fraternity meetings, and we saw each other at different places, and we hung out when we could, but life had kind of gotten in the way, and Mike was trying to get his career going, and I was still in school. So I started getting a little bit depressed. It was in January, and I was starting to feel like I was feeling the pressure of school, and all these people were getting great internships, and I wasn't figuring out what I really wanted to do, and I had all these weird kind of stresses that probably seemed kind of silly to some people, but they're really weighing me down, which is part of the problem with depression, is sometimes you fall into these little pockets of despair, and you can't really figure out why you're sad sometimes, but you are. And so I was in that place, and I had last seen Mike, and about that time, it was around January, I bumped into him in a concert. He was telling me all these great things. He said, "Oh, Craig, it's great. I got this this job. He worked for one big three. His parents were really proud. He had this girlfriend that he got engaged to, and she was awesome. And they were looking for a house, and everything was just great." And I was really proud of him because I knew that he was really striving to really get that acceptance from his parents. Because even though he kind of got bummed out when they wanted him to be a certain way, he really, really just wanted to get their thumbs up, good job. And they talked about how he got this great job that was going to be really good. And it was April 1st, 1999, when I found out that Mike had actually taken his own life. You see, he had had the job, but he had lost it shortly after he had gotten it. And he was so bummed about it that he was afraid to tell anybody, because his parents were so proud of him, and his brother and sister were so excited to talk about it at family gatherings. He didn't want to tell his girlfriend, who is now his fiance, because he was afraid she was going to leave him. And so what he did was he talked to somebody, and he ended up getting a loan for about $20,000. And Mike thought that, well, this loan will be okay. I'll get a job really quickly, and I won't even have to use all of this. But time just kept going, and he couldn't get anything. And days turned into weeks, turned into months. And before he knew it, he was depleting all that money. And he was his fiance, of course, was planning a wedding, and so he was shelling out money for that from the $20,000. And he started to get a little nervous when she wanted to buy a house. And so he thought, well, okay, we'll just keep this ruse going. And he ended up going, and they found a house, and he was kind of didn't know how to really react. And so it was getting close to the time where he had to prove that he had a job. Usually when you buy a house, get a loan, you have to prove that you have a job, show income. And he didn't have that, and he knew that the jig was going to be up, everyone was going to find out. And he ended up taking his own life. And I remember that moment because it was a wake-up call. I'd never really, even though I had been so close to wanting to take my own life so many times before, it was the first time that anyone I knew and was close to it had actually done it. And so we were in the house, and I saw that the effect of everything. It was such a ripple effect. It affected so many lives, and forever it changed it. I mean, every April 1st, I get a text from a buddy that remembers Mike and says, "Hey, we should have a drink for Mike's memory." And it's been years now. So it ripped me apart. Shortly thereafter, I had a cousin, and my cousin committed suicide. He had a whole different story. He had gotten involved in some small crimes, and the police were kind of onto him, and he got scared, and he took his own life. And then upset by that, my aunt, she took her own life shortly after that. And I remember just hearing about this and seeing what he did, and was torn apart by it. I ended up going to a doctor again, getting back on the regimen that helped me so much before. And I seemed to be embracing the fact that what I was doing during those times was really not loving myself. I didn't like myself. I didn't like the things about myself. So I decided to kind of work on that a little bit. Friends of mine went rafting down in Virginia, and I remember looking into it was a calm moment at night. I was looking out over this river, and it was beautiful. And I remember thinking, I need to love this. I need to love who I am. I need to take that in, because I felt like I had never done that before. And it was a great feeling because I came back and I started working on myself. First thing I did was I got an internship at 89X, which is a radio station here in Detroit. And I ended up kind of rising in the ranks there into the promotions department. And then I got the attention from some record labels that saw that I was busting myself to get this stuff going for their bands whenever we were doing station events. So they said, "Hey, why don't you come work for a record label?" So I worked for a record label as an artist development rep. And as an artist development rep, the label would sign these bands, and I would get to work with them. I got to work with a number of bands, including Rascal Flatts. I didn't know that was going to be played today, but it was awesome. And I got to work on getting their careers kind of off and running, which was fantastic. That parlayed into working in entertainment. And working in the film side. So I worked on the marketing department for a lot of these films that we were releasing. And actually, in 2010, my daughter was born. And I remember sitting in my hospital room, my wife was sleeping, and I was holding my daughter, and I was thinking about everything. You know, you take it, my life had changed. You hear about that when you have kids, and you think, oh, if you don't have any kids, you think, okay, I don't understand what this means, your life changes. But it did. It was like a totally new chapter had started. And I was holding her, and I was looking in her face, and she was just so cute, and even though she kind of was so small and wiggly, it was kind of neat to hold her and think about the fact that if I had done any of those things that I wanted to do so badly when I was a teenager, or into my early 20s, that I wouldn't even be experiencing this moment. And then I started thinking about my friend Mike and how he could have been 6 months away from total happiness. He had no idea. We each have a story that's not written yet. And so whenever there's a low, there's a high right around the corner that's going to make your life so much better and so much more wonderful to experience. You have no idea what's waiting for you around the corner. I had no idea that I would be working in music and movies. I had no clue. It was just, I had never even thought that would actually happen, and to actually be able to do it was awesome. And I kind of wished I could have gone back and told the 14-year-old version of myself, don't worry so much, relax, things are going to be all right, no matter what happens. So in 2012, I ended up, the studio we were working with ended up talking about a movie called Bully. Has anyone seen the movie Bully as a documentary? Okay, cool. Cool, yeah. So our studio was putting that out, and we started looking at some early stuff on it, and it was it touched me a little bit differently than other people that I was on the marketing team, because it was such a powerful movie. I felt like it was extremely gut-wrenching. If you haven't had a chance to watch it, I strongly suggest doing it, because what it made me do is it made me realize that what I needed to do really was give back to my community. I wanted to reach out. I had done so many leadership things and had spoken to so many different things that the one thing I needed to really do is get back to trying to make a difference. So I ended up giving up all of that stuff, and Easter Seals had a position open for a communications manager. And so I started looking into it, and to me, Easter Seals had always been one thing. I had only known them as being, they did telethons. I remember that. I remember my grandma talking about those. But what I didn't know is that Easter Seals has been around since 1920, and they offered all these great things that help people with mental health issues. And that was one thing that I had because of the depression, so I recognized that right away. And they had all these groups that helped with that, and they served adults and teens and children, and the gamut was very large. I got really impressed by it. And then I started looking into everything in Oakland County that helped with this and all the different things. And I had known about Common Ground when I was in high school. I used to keep the number in my pocket, actually, because I just felt comfortable that way. And so I was familiar with that, but to come back and be able to work alongside a lot of those people was amazing. So I turned my attention to doing this now. And so it's been a great honor to be able to give back to the community and events like this, and working alongside everybody who is right in your back door that's here in our backyard for helping. So please take as much information from this event tonight as you can. Ask questions. If you know anybody, please direct them to one of the many great resources that are here tonight. Because, like I said, 80% of everybody who seeks treatment does succeed. So thank you very much for everything, you guys. Thank you for coming out here and taking those steps. Thank you.
I think the thing that touched me the most about what Craig said, and I think we've all gone through stages of depression, and I love just hearing the story about when they gave birth to their first daughter, and you know, thinking back to those times where it was the darkest hour, thinking that life wasn't worth it, and then to have this just sheer joy, and it's so easy to get caught up in those moments. So thank you for sharing that, Craig. That was amazing. And so next, we're going to keep moving here with our next presenter, Ethan Paschal. Pascal. Did I say it right? I'm sorry. Pascal. I've seen Ethan around for a while. He's a guy with some crazy blonde hair. I'll tell you a little bit about Ethan. Ethan was born into a missionary family, and so traveling was a very large part of his childhood. He spent a year in France. You speak French? No. Then moved to West Africa for 3 years before finally returning to the United States as a fourth grader. He struggled emotionally and socially during high school, continued switching schools until graduating from Parkway Christian in 2008. While attending Oakland University, before he received his bachelor's degree in psychology, Ethan was given the opportunity to intern for a year as youth pastor at Kensington Church. He was responsible for working with the teens who were members of Kensington's youth group called Edge and were struggling with depression or anxiety. In addition to working on his master's in clinical psychology, Ethan is also the lead vocalist of a band called A Righteous Downfall. Does anybody know this band? See, no hands. I've seen them, I've heard them, and it's hardcore stuff. It's really hardcore. If you're into that music, you definitely should check it out. My mom would say it's yelling. I think he even says it's yelling too, but a lot of the kids really like it now. One of the great things about their group is they, even though it's hardcore and you listen to it and you think that it's crazy, it really is geared towards reaching out to people who are hurting and providing them hope and support through their lyrics. Ethan has coped with depression and survived multiple suicide attempts, and that's a large part of his past and his story and his inspiration for us all tonight. So, like to, no further ado, welcome up Ethan.
Pascal. Thank you. to clarify, I used to speak French, but then got into high school and almost failed because I hadn't used it for so long. So, yes, I actually had a very unique childhood growing up and spent a year in France, as Chris mentioned, and then moved to West Africa for 3 years. And so once I came home from that, it was really difficult for me to get integrated into normal society, I guess, just because I come from a completely different background. And so I struggled a lot with trying to fit in and being able to connect with people. And my whole life growing up, I just felt very much as an outcast. And so when I would come home, my dad was a pastor and both my parents were missionaries, it was this idea that I was the pastor's kid or the missionary's kid. And so I would come home and I was expected to be a specific person. I was seen as a particular type of individual, and I was never supposed to make any mistakes. That was just who I was. And so my life, as I started growing up, I just learned how to fake all of the right moves, how to say the right things, how to be the right person that people expected me to be. And so once I started to get a little bit older in high school, I started realizing that there's people out there that actually believe this, that aren't just going through the motions. There are people who actually genuinely have hope and have faith, not because their parents do, but because that's what they genuinely believe. And so I came to a point where I said, okay, I either need to fully commit my life to be able to move forward and trust and have faith in a God that's there, or have nothing to do with them whatsoever. And so I chose at this time in my life, I wanted nothing to do with God. I said, I'm going to live my life entirely on my own, and I'm going to take everything that comes, and I'm just going to handle it by myself. And so I believe as an individual that we're all born with a sense of wanting to love and wanting to feel loved and a sense of belonging and really a need to worship. And so for me, having made this decision that I wanted nothing to do with God, I had this void in my life and this need that I had to fill somehow. And so in my teenage mind, I filled it. I said, well, I just have to find a girl. I have to find a relationship. Because if I can find a relationship, then I'll have this sense of belonging, this sense of being cared for and loved. And so I just started going through relationship after relationship, and everyone ended up being worse than the one before it. And my entire life at this point was completely defined by the perceptions of the people who were around me. My entire worth was based off of how these girls I was with saw me. And so when each of them at different times would end up leaving, then my life would completely shatter. And I would start realizing that I put all of my hope and trust into something that ultimately wasn't going to be there. And so that was when my depression really started to get out of control. And the longer that I went hiding it inside, the more that I isolated myself, the worse it got. And I struggled with self-harm a lot at this time as well. And my parents tried very hard to try and be there for me. And it's interesting because no one starts out knowing how to be a parent. Nobody goes in, you can read hundreds of books and you're still not going to know what to do in certain situations. And so my parents struggled to try and help me as much as they could. And a lot of times they would make different mistakes, like they looked at blaming a lot of outside influences as the cause of my pain, and so they would take away the movies I'd watch, or take away the music I'd listen to, or different things like that. That for me, I didn't feel that that was the root cause. It certainly influenced me a lot in a very negative way, but to me, it was almost belittling that I had all of these emotions and all of these things inside of me that were coming from me, not from these outside sources. And so I pushed my parents away as much as I possibly could. And they continued to try and be there for me. And as they started to learn more about what it was like to try and work with me, they were able to be there and say, it doesn't matter how much you push us away, we're still going to be here. And so I ended up taking out a lot of my anger and a lot of my hatred on my parents during this time, because they were there, and they were the closest people to me. And so they were who so much of my anger was directed toward. And so around the time of my junior year of high school, once things started to really spiral out of control, I ended up with a girl who we were together for about a year, and I just told myself, this is the one, this is who I can put all of my trust in, and she's always going to be there. I don't need to be loved by anyone else because I have this person here. And so one night, I got a phone call from her, and in a lot of words she explained that we were over. And for me, it wasn't any one event that put me over to this point, but this particular event was really the last straw for me. And I had gotten so broken in this point that this one event, to me, was what pushed me over the edge. And I can't do this anymore. I can't keep moving forward. And so I ended up going in my bathroom, and I'd been on a lot of different medications, and I had made the mistake of keeping any empty pill bottles or half-empty pill bottles that I hadn't finished, and I ended up taking those and ended up laying on my bed and waiting for them to take effect. And as I laid there and nothing was happening, I realized that it wasn't ending yet, and so I ended up hurting my entire body from my neck to my waist, my entire arms. And I laid on my bed and waited. And I was so broken in this moment. I was so against everything that I'd grown up believing. All that mattered to me right then was trying to get out, trying to relieve this pain. And I mistakenly thought that this was the answer to get away from it all. So as I laid on my bed, this thought started coming up in my head over and over, and it just kept replaying that it's not your time, this isn't it. And I remember I was fighting that thought so hard because of how convinced I was of what I wanted to do with my life in that moment. But for whatever reason, this thought kept coming up and I couldn't explain it. And as I was going in and out of consciousness at this point, I stand up and I'm walking down the stairs. And next thing I know, I'm walking into my parents' room in the middle of the night, and I just start screaming, I need a hospital. I need a hospital. And as I explained, my relationship with my parents at this point was horrible. And the amount of threats and anger that I'd unleashed on them so regularly was such a big part of my life. I still remember, because my mom had on a pink nightgown, my dad had on a white shirt. And I will never forget the image when they turned on the lights and they saw me. Because in that moment, it didn't matter to them how much blood I was covered in. It didn't matter how many times I pushed them away. How many times I told them that I hated them. That I didn't care what they had to say, and that I didn't believe that they loved me. Because in that moment, all that mattered to them was wrapping their arms around me and making sure that I understood that I mattered, that they loved me, and that I was safe. So they were able to get me in a van, and we started heading over to a hospital. And on my way there, I end up getting a text message, and I read the text message, and it said Psalm 118:8. It is far better to take refuge in the Lord than to put your trust in man. And it was from a number I didn't recognize. I just thought, this is weird. I don't believe this stuff anymore. I don't know what it is, but whatever. So I end up getting in the hospital, and they end up bandaging me up and having me drink stuff to counteract the pills that I'd taken. And I ended up getting sent to Havenwick Mental Hospital. And while I was there, it was the first time in my life that I was actually able to take time and think about why I was here. I was able to finally get away from all of the distractions and all of the things that I refused to actually face. I was able to, for the first time, start actually talking to God. I was able to actually look at my life and examine it in a way that I'd never had the opportunity to before. And while I was there, that verse kept popping up in my head over and over and over. So I ended up getting out of the hospital and talking to my parents. And I found out that while I was in there, my mom had tried to find out a little bit more about this story. She didn't really have a whole lot of explanation from me at the time. And so she'd gone through my phone and looked through and pieced together and seen the phone calls from this girl and started to figure out more about what was going on. And when she was able to see this message, she wanted to thank the person who sent it to me. Because every time that they'd visit me in the hospital, all I could talk about was this verse and how it was exactly what I was doing up until this point, that I just continued to put everything that I had into all of these people around me who were struggling with the exact same things that I was. And so she ended up going to our phone carrier store, and actually a couple different stores, and talked to them and said, like, can we trace this number so I'd be able to find out who it belongs to so I can properly thank them for what they did. And the guy ended up checking the number, and he came to her and explained this phone number doesn't exist. He explained that there's no possible way that you could have received a text message from this number. And you're welcome to believe whatever you believe. I know what I believe, and I know exactly what happened. Because I follow a God who is so much more powerful than I can imagine, who loves us so much more than anyone realizes. And so I started to take moments like that and started to give pieces of my life over to God and start striving toward actually getting help, toward actually living a healthy life. And I was able to repair my relationship with my parents so much from this point, to be able to finally say, I'm going to stop pushing you away.
And everybody seems to have everything memorized, and I brought notes. All right. I'm Lori Gell with TTI, which is for Outpatient Mental and Substance Abuse Treatment. We have the privilege of working with all sorts of individuals in many counties, including Cleveland County, which is really awesome because I'm all over the place. No individual fits into one box, because that would be really cool if it did, because we can fix all kinds of problems, but like, you know, we don't. So we have diverse based programs and treatments that meet needs for all kinds of individuals, such as dialectical behavior therapy, assertive community-based treatment, case management, young adult, residential, and recovery supports. Trust me, I'm not going to bore you with all kinds of programs and treatments we have. I'm just going to kind of give you an overview. We also have programs in each of those treatment modalities. We have psychiatric, psychologists, like Amelia said, peer advocates, which are individuals that have come to us for treatment in the past, done really, really well in those treatment programs and can relate to individuals coming back to us. So, like, if an individual comes to us for treatment and they would like somebody that's been there before and not just somebody that went to school, they can see one of our peer advocates. So it works really, really well. Like in our young adult program, it's somebody that's also a young adult relating to somebody in that kind of age range, which is 18 to 26. We also have tons of group therapies, like assertiveness group, depression group, family psychoed, which is only a few of them. Unfortunately, right now, suicide is a huge thing in our community, in our society. When I was in high school, which was a little bit ago, I'm not going to tell you how long, we really didn't talk about it. It was kind of whispered. We didn't have colleagues like myself and my associates talking to individuals in public forums or coming to schools and doing the things that we do right now. I actually was trying to remember if I ever had this kind of thing. It was whispered about. If I had a friend that actually had any depression, we kind of didn't see them for a little while, or they just dealt with it on their own. So this is really, really awesome that you guys are actually here. This is a huge, big step. If this is your first one, or another step to kind of strengthen our community and work together to help everybody. So, keeping up with the positives of support and treatment and education, there's a huge announcement for training and treatment innovations. We received a grant for mental health first aid and youth mental health first aid, which is a training that we are able to provide all across Michigan. And it is free, which is, don't get all excited. It's really exciting for us. Who doesn't like free? It's a free training to be able to educate the community on how to intercede in crisis situations. Kind of like first aid and CPR. Anybody ever had first aid and CPR? Nobody? Couple? You'll teach it when you need it? Okay. So it's kind of like in that realm. Show this mental health first aid, and the youth mental health first aid is kind of on that same wavelength is the idea. Show that we can all be there in the community and be able to recognize those symptoms if somebody is feeling depressed or if somebody is going through a crisis. And no, it's not to be able to rush everybody into treatment. The idea is to be able to recognize the people that may benefit from more treatment or may need just somebody to talk to a little bit longer. So we're hoping to educate teachers and even people in the churches and neighbors and your friends, you, haha. I have a booth out there with some classes that are available, and they are free. You get this great book for reference, and so any information that you may need or any flyers, anything like that, please feel free to stop by and ask me about it. But I do want to thank you guys for coming out and, you know, commend you for making that big step in information.
It was after the first time I kept it to myself because I thought it was just kind of a weird thing that my brain kind of was going to go a weird place. But it was after the second time, it was because I had gotten a little bit further in the, I don't want to really call it an attempt, but I got further in the process, and it was extremely scary for me, and I knew that it was just a matter of time before I kept getting closer and closer until it became dangerous. So I went to him, and I just said, I need help, and I need it right away, or else I'm going to hurt myself. I can't not seek treatment. They had actually seen some signs a little earlier. It started roughly from about third grade. I started having, I would get angry for no reason a lot of times. And they just kind of thought it was some sort of anger management issue, but it was because they could tell that there's pressure building up there. And I had gone to a different school. They had actually transferred me to a different school, thinking that would kind of help. And it kind of did, but it kind of didn't. But they started seeing some signs early on that they should take me seriously for that. So I cried really easily. I got very emotional. I shut down. I got very quiet. And so they were able to pick up on those signs. And so they at that point decided that it was time to seek help. So I want to say I was seeing a psychiatrist within about 3 weeks from that initial approach to my parents.
A health clinician for the Easter Seals of Michigan. So thanks for being here, Bridget.
You're welcome. Thank you for having me. I was also going to add, if you've probably already done this, but to do as much research you can on anxiety and panic disorder. When you can attest to this part, probably, the anxiety itself is more anxiety provoking. And so oftentimes when you're struggling with the anxiety, you're thinking, well, what's wrong with me? Why am I having this anxiety? And then you're worried about the next anxiety attack coming on. And so as a parent, if you can do as much research and understand what anxiety is, because it's very real, it's very scary, and it's physical. It's a physical thing. And a lot of us who don't necessarily struggle from it directly feel like it's all in the head. But when someone is suffering from an anxiety or panic attack, it's very physical, it's very real, and it's extremely terrifying. So as the person being the support person, if you do a lot of research and try and really understand as much as you can about what your daughter is really struggling with, so that you can be as empathetic as possible. And I think that the way Ethan, you shared your story was terrific, and that you shared that your parents constantly just said, we're here, we're here, we're here. And that mantra over and over again will also prove to be, in the long run, keep in mind that it's also not going to happen overnight. That it is something that your daughter will probably struggle with. Will struggle with for the rest of her life. She will learn to cope with it, but it won't just magically go away. So it is going to be something that will take some time.
Thank you. Okay.
Suicidal thoughts are a combination of environmental, genetics, biologies, physiologies. It's a combination of issues. So I don't want to label there's these top three things. It's important to recognize in ourselves and in each other, you know, what triggers that we have. Life changes can be a trigger for individuals. If they're moving out of state, if their parents are getting divorced, if there's a trauma in the family, a trauma with the individual, you know, those can be triggers and something to watch out for. If they're, oftentimes we see, we notice sudden changes in behavior, whether they, you know, are an introvert and they become an extrovert, or they're an extrovert and become an introvert and they just, you know, they start isolating from other people, or they're engaging in reckless behavior. You know, these are some of the things that we've seen in individuals, but it's also a very individualized thing. We've heard stories this evening that it was very internal. It's hard to reach out. It's hard to explain what's going on in our heads. But once we recognize in ourselves, you know, this is something that I'm struggling with, we can start, you know, thinking, considering, even beforehand, tonight, perhaps, you go home and you consider the three people that you'll talk to. If you're struggling, you're going through a hard time, the three things that you can do to get yourself out of a bad mood or a bad situation, and three professional supports. I'll tell you, you've got Common Ground, TTI, and Easter Seals here, so maybe those could be your professional supports. But just coming up with a game plan, a safety plan for yourself before something happens. So I don't want to say that, you know, these are the common denominators, but because it's a combination of things in our lives.
Thank you. The biggest thing is going to be choosing what you want to do after you lose a child to suicide. And that may sound weird, but I could go either way. I could have gone and just buried my head in the sand, or I could do what I've been doing, which is just trying to bring it out, let go of the stigma. You made a good comment about talk to somebody about it, because there's so many different things that we identify that are the causes or why, but the stigma associated with it is just unbearable for some people. And it was for me for a bit, but it wasn't going to change anything. Ryan was gone. I couldn't bring him back. So with the help of guys like Chris and Carl and Michelle Novak and some of the other folks, Mary and Janopoulos, who, for those of you who are in this school district, if it wasn't for her, a lot of this wouldn't be happening. And I've been sitting back there thinking that Kevin Briel not being here, to me, and having what we have tonight is a godsend. Because Chris is our township supervisor, and Chris has been involved with this from day one, with me personally. He's my friend. And to have him support what we're trying to do is amazing. That's it. But to support other parents who've lost children to suicide is don't tell them you know how they're feeling, because you don't. It's the worst feeling ever. I can attest to that. Try to do the things Amelia said. Ethan, what you did with your parents is what it's all about. Lori, your training is amazing. Craig, that's good stuff.
So, thank you. What was it? 90 seconds. I still love you. If you have further follow-up, we're going to have time for one. Let me ask you a real quick one. This is my own. So social media, almost all kids are on it. There's like 9 different ones to try to keep up with, which is stressful as a parent.
take on that, and then, you know, I've personally seen some calls for help, you know, I can't take this anymore, stuff like that. What's your recommendation if you, regarding social media and messages from students like that?
Social media is huge today. Counterground has seen that, and we've jumped aboard with our crisis text and chat programs. We have it available through our website and a local text number, 248-809-5550. And we've also jumped, we've also partnered with a national, the crisis text line. So we know where kids are at. They're online, they're on their phones, they're on the phones online. And it's important to take notice what your kids are doing on social media networks, because that's where a lot of them socialize. And they can socialize 24 hours a day. It's at their fingertips. I was probably updating the status not too long ago myself. But a lot of the social media now has, they have availability. If they're suicidal content or suicidal threat, you can report to the host site, and they can either connect them with the National Suicide Prevention Lifeline, which are a provider for, or they can directly contact that person and get them the help and supports that they're looking for. So it's important to notice, you know, what their latest tweets are, or what they're posting on Facebook or Reddit is new. You know, it's important to be involved in your children's lives and to take notice of what is being said and what's being put out there. You know, whether it's just, you know, they're stating their frustrations for the day, or whether they have, you know, serious intent with, you know, what they're posting. They're looking for, you know, attention, and, you know, we can support that and address it and say, you know, I took notice, or your friends, you know, said they saw this on your Twitter, you know, why don't we talk about that? So it's important to take anything seriously and use it as a conversation piece. You don't have to, you know, say, why did you post that? You can say, you know, what's going on with that? I'm just concerned, and, you know, why don't we talk about that? Because, you know, you're putting it out there. The internet is not a secret place. So, you know, take notice and address those when they come up.